Last Sunday on Easter, I talked about beginning this new series this week that I'm excited about, and which we're talking about how all things have a beginning. Everything has a starting point to it. Basically, even you had a starting point. Some of you were started on purpose. Some of you, like me, maybe just lucky to be here, but feel like it was a surprise and a pleasant surprise, and made it into the world, and excited to be here, and really glad to be here, like I am. But everything has a starting point. Everything has a beginning point. Romance, relationships, marriages, your first day of school, starting point. Remember that first day in kindergarten, flowers, animals, marriage, parenting, even the creation of the world. When Albert Einstein discovered the theory of relativity, he discovered that the way the universe is expanding, he decided from fact now that the universe had a beginning, and he made the statement, "I fear it had a beginner," because it had a beginning. And so everything has a beginning, and even our faith has a starting point. And you may think back to years back or somewhere in your history, you had a beginning, though your faith had a beginning. And from my early years on, and maybe your early years on, our faith had a framework about it. And this, I got a slide really to show basically the framework of our faith, and that is basically that God is good. And he rewards those who do good, and he punishes those who do evil. And we believe that God answers prayer, and that he speaks. So He's good, and you've maybe always heard that. He rewards those who do good. He punishes those who do evil. And so, of course, in my childhood faith, it was the team or the basketball team or the baseball team that had the most Christians on it that was going to win the game. You know, that was my theology, you know, all the way going towards middle school. Well, we must have had more good people on our team. They might have more bad people on their team. So they lost, and we won. And that's just how life works and things. And so there's a cause and effect and a reward and punishment. And then we also believe that God answers prayer. And then he, that's not only just one way, but he speaks to us. We speak to him, and he speaks to us, and he listens. And so the fact that he speaks to us, I was thinking about the story of Eli and Samuel. You probably heard of that, where Samuel goes to Eli, the priest who's taking care of him, and Samuel hears an audible voice, and then he goes back to his room to lay down again. He hears the audible voice again, goes back to Eli and says, "Eli, I'm hearing a voice." And first Eli's thinking he's just hearing things or something, but then it happens again. He says, "Samuel, the next time you hear the voice, say, 'Your servant, Lord, is listening.' Speak, Lord, your servant is listening." And so the Bible supports the fact that God speaks to us. I think sometimes maybe for pastors' families, and these Bible stories and things have even more meaning, or sometimes some weirdness with them, because I remember being at home with mom and sitting inside our living room with her, and dad was out working on the furnace, and soon through the heating vent we heard this, Sharon, this is God. Say that your servant is listening, so I can tell you God wants you to be a submissive woman to your handsome husband, John." So some of these stories in the Old Testament really come alive in the pastor's families. I was thinking another pastor's family. It must be something with pastor's kids, because one of my favorite pastors, Andy Stanley, who's the son of Charles Stanley, who a lot of people heard on the TV and radio and things, and he said his parents would tell him at night before going to bed, "If God speaks to you, Andy, tell him your servant is listening." And then they would turn off the light and close the door. And Annie said, "Then I would pray this prayer, 'God, if you're going to speak to me, do not do it at night here. Do it in the middle of the day with all my friends around. Otherwise, mom's going to have to put the plastic sheets back on the bed, because this is not going to be okay with me, having God speak to me while I'm laying here by myself." And so maybe you're that like that too. Maybe it'd freak you out if God spoke to you audibly. But you know, we speak to him in prayer, and he speaks to us in our life, not always an audible voice. I don't know if anyone's had that audible voice experience, but he speaks to us. And this is all part of our framework of faith. of being in the church, of growing up in the church, a childlike faith, a childhood faith that we grew up with. And then there comes a time where there's something just that's wrong or in troubling about this framework for our childhood faith. There comes a point in our life when our childhood faith gets disrupted because things in our life that are happening don't really fit neat into that package that we've had for so long and such since kids. Nothing just fits so neatly into that anymore. We see people that do evil and they seem to be flourishing and doing great and being rewarded by this world. We see other people that we know are good people that love the Lord and they're suffering and they're struggling and bad things are happening to them. And we know of a childhood that God answers prayer, but you say, heck, he didn't answer my prayer. My mom or dad was about ready to pass, or my childhood friend was ran over by a car. He didn't answer my, I prayed that God would spare his life, and he died anyway. And so that childhood faith gets disrupted because life has a way of chipping away at our childhood faith. And many adults today seems either irrelevant or is completely gone from what they started with. Kelly has a friend at work, and she's not a believer, and her friend will tell her she thinks all religions and faiths have just been made up by man. She, however, finds my wife delightful, and I would say, who can blame her? My wife is a delightful woman and very sensitive and a caring woman and is praying for this gal, even though this gal would be mad at her to know she's praying for her. But what Kelly has noticed is that this gal's got lots of Christian friends around her praying for her. But over this last year her mother died. And this year, during the school day at school, she was notified that her sister had just been diagnosed with cancer. That was just a month and a half ago. And she's just since passed a week ago. And Kelly and I have to ask the questions, what are you doing, Lord? We're just beginning to pray for this gal. How is she so angry and mad and bitter? And how is she going to come to know you? But Kelly noted that all the ladies that are surrounding this woman with love are Christians. She says, well, what is God up to? I said, well, I don't understand all things like that, but I know that God wants to bring everyone to himself. He desires that not one would perish, but that all would come to eternal life. I know that we serve a God that is love. And even time these are hard to understand, but I don't know what God is up to, but I know it certainly takes an understanding that goes beyond this life itself. It certainly goes to having an understanding, a theological belief that evolves beyond what we knew as children. Karen Armstrong says it best this way in the book, The Case for God. I've got a slide because it's a long quote. It says, many of us have been left stranded. It's a good word. Many of us have been left stranded with an incoherent concept of God. We learned about God at the same time that we were told about Santa Claus. But while our understanding of the Santa Claus phenomena evolved and matured, our theology remained somewhat infantile. Not surprisingly, when we attained intellectual maturity, many of us rejected the God we had inherited and denied that he existed. So often I see kids and teenagers where everything around them matured except their understanding of God. It didn't further develop. I think it's no surprise that one of the biggest dips in age groups of church attendance, at least temporarily, is right when a child is leaving the high school years and going off to college. And it's either going to show up whether they had a faith that was on the curtails of their parents or whether they have their genuine own faith that they own. Too many adults walking around there need a new starting point for faith. I said last week in my Easter message, I wanted to spend the next couple months helping people know where faith begins and how to get it started or restarted because their childhood faith just no longer is doing it in this adult world that's all around them. But here's the good news. Here's the good news. As the Bible says, it was not the starting point for faith when Christianity began. Some of you are thinking, you know, I tell my friends that the Bible is the Word of God, and rightfully so, that it is infallible and inerrant, and we serve an omnipresent God and omnipotent and all-powerful and just an amazing God. And we know that because the Bible says, and it is a sacred book, and I've been taught that ever since I was just a wee one with the Bible, that the Bible says, and I can hold on to that, and that can be a core resource for my life. But a lot of the culture that's growing up today, they either grew up in a family and the Bible, maybe it was said to be important, but it was never read. And they heard a preacher on Sunday preaching, but they never really were understanding what he was talking about. And because of that, now we live in a culture that the Bible says is just not having much relevance, or it's an inadequate, at least, starting point for many of the adults that we're trying to reach in our communities today. You can see evidence of that all around us in books that are written. Jesus in an age of controversy, God's word in an age of controversy. And any time, many more, you might just say the Bible says to a friend and things, and you just kind of look like, well, isn't that another holy book? Isn't that another thing to be read? Or so here's the good news, is the Bible says was not the starting point for faith when Christianity began. The New Testament canon, that's the theological name that we have for the collection of ancient documents that were brought together over years from many different authors, over many thousands of years, into this collection of documents that we call the Bible or the canon. They were written from people of all walks of life, some rich people, some poor people, some peasants, some kings, some great articulate, well-written people like the book of Romans because of the Apostle Paul. Other, a little bit more raw. Over maybe 1,500 years. People writing down documents and just putting in a collection. So when we say the Bible says and things, what we're talking about is the individual documents that were brought together that in a miraculous way all have one theme. All have one idea pointing to Jesus Christ's. Is being the Son of God. So it took until about the third century, about 300 years after the death and resurrection of Christ, we finally have a canon. We finally have the scriptures all together in what we now call the Bible, and Christians would gather together still, and Christians would grow in Christ, and they would even go out and share about the gospel, but they would never open their Bibles because they didn't exist for 300 years. Christians were doing this. So what was the first century Christians' beginning point without an organized Bible? What'd they gather around? What'd they read? What'd they do? Because the beginning point that they had should be the beginning point that we have. That'll be applicable to reach the pluralistic society and culture that we live in today that matches the pluralistic society and culture that they had back then. And the apostles and disciples didn't shrink back from that fact. They embraced it and changed the world. And the power of Christ. It was a great big beginning point that we're going to talk about today. So here's some of the pre-stories. We're going to look at some of the writings from a man named Paul that used to be Saul. I shared a little bit about him in the Easter story under the subject of changed lives. And the reason why he's such a changed life is because he was on his way to Damascus to stamp out the church. He was a Pharisee. He had a good position, a good job within the Jewish hierarchy. He was a zealot. He was passionate about what he did. And he's on his way to Damascus to kill Christians, to imprison them. And on his way, a bright light knocks him off his horse and says, "Saul, Saul, why are you persecuting me?" And he says, "Persecuting who?" And the voice coming at him, this bright light, I kid you not, says, "Jesus, I am Jesus who you are persecuting." Very personally, you're not stamping out a religion, you're not stamping out a belief system. He says, "I'm Jesus who you're persecuting." And Saul is blinded by this. And his life is forever changed because he becomes a Christian. The very movement that he was trying to stamp out and kill and destroy, he becomes one of them. And then he begins to be discipled, and then he begins to write. And he begins to write in traveling journals. And then he begins to write letters to some of the churches that he begins. He begins churches, and then he writes letters to them. And he writes journals about his documenting his experiences. And these ancient documents make themselves into what we call the Bible today. And you can know that Paul wrote down and shared the things that he shared Not because he got it out of the Bible. He wrote down the things he knew, not because of documents that he had already read or articles he got. He knew what he knew because the people he knew. People that were living along with Paul, that were contemporaries with him, were guys like Peter, who was discipled with him in his discipleship group for a while. And he was with James, and he was with John. And he found out and he began to grow in this movement that he now embraced because he also knew what he knew because he who he knew because he spoke into the sky and knew that he was persecuting this Jesus who he knew as a movement on the planet Earth before he was crucified and then claimed to be arose. So, so important to know that back in this day, Paul's starting point again was not the Bible. Didn't exist. His starting point was who he knew. And he began to write these things down, write down his experiences and his conversations that he had had with Jesus, and just tells his story. Today, this man's experience and writings come to us from Athens, Greece, one of his stops along the way of planting and encouraging churches. We're going to look at Acts 17, 16 through 34 today. That's where we're going to rest in the Bible today and see the story and how we can look at the first starting points of the early Christians and help give us clues as to how to interact and engage the culture and build our faith in today's world. Acts 17, verse 16. While Paul was waiting for them in Athens. Now let's just stop right there. I always ask the question when I'm reading this in the Bible. What's he waiting for? Why is he waiting? Why is it just Paul? You know, it's dangerous to travel alone at these times and things. Why Paul? Why is he just waiting in Athens? Well, Paul is an interesting individual in that everywhere he went, he wasn't content to just say, oh, let's just live and let live. Let's not rustle any feathers. Paul was not like that. Paul was a very interesting and feisty individual that could not back down from what he believed. He was compelled to share the things that he knew, and he wanted everybody else to know. So while he's waiting in Athens, it's because he'd just been preaching in Thessalonica. First he was there, and he was preaching, and an angry mob raised up and ran him out of town trying to find him, and they finally go to the house where he's to be found, but he snuck out at night and headed to the town of Berea. And he handles there, and he begins to preach the gospel there. And he says the people are a little bit more receptive to him there, so maybe he's planning on staying around. But the angry mob from Thessalonica follows him there. And they're hunting him down there. Well, Silas and Timothy says, Paul, you better get out of here. And so they send a couple brothers with him, a couple believers. They escort him to Athens, to the beach. Like, let's send him to the beach. Maybe he'll stay out of trouble there. And we'll just join you there. And so that's what Paul's doing. He's waiting in Athens because he's had his rear end chased all the way back from the last several towns he's been at. Begs the question of us Christians today. Like, man, maybe if there's never any adversity or if there's never any coming against you, maybe we're not sharing the gospel like we should. At least like Paul did. I don't know. Sometimes I'm convicted as I read the things about Paul and seeing that he didn't even try and stay out of trouble. A lot of times I try and stay out of trouble. I try and keep people calm. Like, harmony good, chaos bad. You know, my wife loving me, great. Being in trouble with her, bad. And I live that life philosophy a lot of time, more harmoniously and maybe more like a Barnabas or something, you know. But Paul, it also points to the question, some might say the gospel seems offensive. Has anyone noticed that but me? There's the culture we're living in today. It seems like sometimes I just say Jesus is Lord and his way or the highway, you know, and people get mad about that. Well, as you know, we're going to look at these verses. Paul, he heads to Athens, and it says Paul was waiting for them in Athens, waiting for the guys that were going to meet him there because he gets ran out of town everywhere he goes. But he's at the next town, and it says he was greatly distressed to see that the city was full of idols. So he reasoned in the synagogue with both Jews and God-fearing Greeks, as well as in the marketplace day by day with those who happened to be there. So Paul's distressed. Why is he distressed? Because Athens is full of statues that people are holding up as gods. And Paul knows the one living God, the one that showed up to him even in the sky with a bright light that knocked him off his horse. He knows Peter, John, and James. He knows about the death and resurrection of Christ. He knows that same Christ spoke to him out of the sky, the blinding light, something he experienced, something that was powerful in his life. And it bothers him that people are worshiping these sticks and stones and things with faces on them, and it seems ridiculous to him. He's distressed. And you might think, he should be distressed. What a stupid, primitive culture. These people are just dumb as heck. Why in the world? Paul should be distressed and angry about this. But are you bothered? Are you distressed about the idolatry here in the United States? Sure, we're not worshiping sticks and stones and things and worshiping statues and things, but aren't we worshiping still the things that money can buy, things that can be made by man? Don't we worship what is the greatest cars, or what kind of house we'd like to live in, or what kind of vacations we'd like to get? Or don't we worship kind of our ideas or ideals about what success is? Don't we grade each other on kind of what they made? What kind of work do you do? Oh, you're that, well, that's good. Oh, you do that, you don't say much because you're not that impressed. Isn't there all kinds of idolatry that we don't need to kid ourselves around and thinking that we're no longer idol worshipers, or idolatry comes into? Because anything that becomes as important to us or takes more of our time and energy and love and affection than God becomes an idol. Here in just a couple weeks, the children's ministry is going to do a musical called The American Ideal instead of American Idol. And it's going to talk a little bit about this, about how we worship ourselves by worshiping things and things. And it's the same thing that Paul was just distressed about. And so Paul, he begins to reason with people in the synagogue, the churches, but also says in the marketplace, day by day with those who happen to be there. Who do he share the gospel with? Those who happen to be there. If you met Paul that day, he would have this kind of idea like, whoa, it's lucky for you to see me today, because I'm about ready to tell you the most important information you're ever going to hear in your life. The power for salvation. You're going to finally hear about what life is really all about. Aren't you excited? And he's about ready to share him that. And so ever since the Lord became the light of his life, he had to share it. He was never quiet about it. Does it sound at all like Paul became a little bit less low-key in Athens? I don't think he knew how. So he was about ready to share, even the places of worship, the marketplace. Somebody think, oh, no, that's a no-no, isn't it, to share about God and the business place? You can't, put that out there. You can get in trouble. You can lose your job. I don't think Paul was just, hey, the people that are there, business place, just worship in the neighborhood, don't matter. I need to share. This is their lucky day to hear about how to have salvation, how to have life to its fullest, how to have eternal life. Verse 18 talks about a group of Epicureans and Stoic philosophers begin to debate with him. Some of them ask, what is this babbler trying to say? Others remarked, he seems to be advocating foreign gods. They said this because Paul was preaching the good news about Jesus and the resurrection. So we need to know who these people are. The Epicureans, they were a philosophy group that believed that the highest good is pleasure. You gotta like these guys, right? Freedom from disturbance or pain is what Webster's Dictionary describes these places. They loved to talk and ask questions. But really, when things got tense or things got, was disrupting a little bit about the community of the Epicureans, they would say, oh, well, let's just ask questions and talk. It's like, but things get tense, let's just have another drink. Have another glass of wine. Because they just wanted things to kind of be groovy. Everything's groovy. There'd be those people in society we still have today. It's all good. It's all good. There's no reason to get all, get your shorts all in a bundle. Just relax. Just drink. Have another drink. You know people like that, because I know people like that. You might consider, hey, they're great people and things to a point. And then the Stoics come along. The Stoic philosophers, they're like their name, free from passion, joy, or much emotion. They believed you submit without any complaint to the unavoidable necessities. The repression of emotion and indifference to pain or pleasure. These guys are the exact opposite. And they believe through questions and logic that you could solve all the issues of mankind. And we have these people today. Oh, they're very serious people, and they're very serious just with a false premise that they believe it's we just educate people more if they just grow in their own philosophies, if we just help people help themselves by giving them even free educations or whatever else, if man just betters themselves, then they'll think better, and we as a community of mankind, of human beings, we will solve the earth's issues. Because every issue and every problem can be solved if we just ask enough questions and get to the end of things. And so here Paul is, this group over here of, hey, it's cool. And this group over here on, hey, we need to get to the bottom of this to find out who you are and what you're saying. What is this babbler trying to say? It seems to be advocating foreign gods. Some of you might think today, well, you know, that's not a big deal. That's not a charge. It was a serious charge in this time. Because advocating a foreign god, if you brought a new god up to this place in Athens, you needed a license. You needed to have a permit because lives were on the line. In the past in Athens, under different gods being added, there was wars that were started. The city was split at one time. And so you just don't bring in foreign gods. And so they took him to a place called the Areopagus. It's pictured here. Some of them call it Mars Hill. There's another picture of it too that's really got the top of it. The next picture, there's right at the top of the rock. And even some churches today are called Mars Hill and things. It's because of this location. And this is where all the serious decisions of the city of Athens was made. They would bring it to the place. The council would make judgments here. They would talk about future ideas that would have implications affecting the people of the city that would be debated. It was a place of seriousness. And it says in 19, they took him here and brought him here to the meeting of the Areopagus, where they said to him, may we know what this new teaching is that you are presenting. You are bringing some strange ideas to our ears, and we would like to know what they mean. And so they bring him to this place, and they say, okay, Paul, start from the beginning. What are your ideas? And people, they just listen to him. You know, the Epicureans, like, hey, let's just give the guy a break. Listen to what he has to say. And the Stoics, like, hey, get your point. We want to know if this is something we're going to throw you out of here, or is this going to be acceptable. If you get a new god here, we'll decide. You just put out your ideas, and we'll be the judge of it. Well, verse 21 gives us a little more insight of the city, too. It says, all the Athenians and the foreigners who lived there spent their time doing nothing but talking about listening to the latest ideas. Some of you guys in the room, you're thinking, oh, Grant, I know this scene. I know who these guys are. Guys that hang out in coffee shops, you know, they don't really have real jobs or things. They just talk about philosophy and things. Maybe they just talk about their ideas and tell you, you know, think we'd never be into this. And us guys think we would never be into this at all. This just sounds like a waste of time. And if there's anything I've noticed in this life, there's no shortage of life philosophies. There's no shortage of talk shows. Anyone know what the number of talk shows there are on TV right now? You can't count them all, I don't think. Amount of Gallup polls, news and gossip programs. You see, you know, the tabloids, I think I already mentioned, but there's no shortage of people saying this is what people are saying. I think there's a reason the Lord called us sheep. We're just so interested. What's the going trend? What's the fashion? What's happening over here? What's that? You know, we just kind of place to place, finding out what's the news, what's the gossip, what's the thing, what's the new thing, what kind of cabinets and colors are people painting, what kind of house colors are going on right now, what kind of cars are people driving, what kind of brands are in right now, is it Nike, is it Reebok, is it New Balance, what's in? And a lot of us guys, we think, well, at least this doesn't happen today, right? At least this doesn't happen today. People just talking for the sake of talking about things that have no meaning or really any substance to it at all. He's just talking for the sake of talking. We don't have that today, do we? I can tell you that I used to watch a basketball game on TV or a football game. I mean, I've been watching the March Madness. That's on my mind right now and things stuff. But I'd watch a basketball game, and the game would be over. And I knew what I saw. I knew how the game went. Break it down in my mind. That was a great game. You know, this game could have done better than that. I walk away and go on and do something else. Most guys now, we watch the game, and then there's an hour post-game show that breaks down everything that you just saw on TV as you watch the game. And you spend an extra hour of your life sitting in your chair, and your wife's asking you, isn't the game over? Yeah, but this is why this team won. I see they scored more points over here than this team. I think that's why they lost. We do the same thing in politics, though, don't we? Like, you have a debate on TV, we got this party going against this party, and you hear everything they say, and you kind of like this guy because the way he, like, presented himself, and this guy had a better joke over here, you know, but this guy, you know, I like these guys' ideas, this guy seems very compassionate, and the whole debate's over, and then they bring on these commentators that for the next hour tell you what you just heard and how you're supposed to feel about. And then they even grade it for you on who won the debate. Whether you think someone else won the debate, that's no good news at all because they'll tell you who won the debate. And the polls reflect that thing. And then all the little sheep just go, well, whoever the poll's saying is the leader, I'm for that guy. This is how to just give you a good idea of what's happening even back in the day in Athens, Greece. It's Paul saying, hey, these people, they just hang out and talk about talking. That's what human beings do, and you just go off how they're feeling. And so in verse 22, Paul begins to stand up. Paul then stood up in the meeting of the Areopagus, and he says, people of Athens, I see that in every way you are very religious. Now some of you in the room think, that's great, good for Paul. So he saw that they are religious, and religion is good. And then some of you get kind of disheartened by some Gallup polls and stuff that's saying people are less religious a little bit today, you know, and you think, well, what does that mean, you know, because religious just kind of basically means that they're disciplined or they follow a certain discipline and things. It's not necessarily even the right faith. But people, let me tell you that even though you see polls and things and stuff, religion is booming around the world. It has never been bigger. It's bigger this century than last century. It's bigger this year than last year. Around the world, religion is having a bigger pull, a bigger a grasp on people around the world. And I would say it's not always good. You think, well, aren't you a religious man and everything? I'm a person of faith. I know who my God is. But these people, it says, are just very, you're religious in every way, and it gives him the ground floor to begin talking to those people. Greeks then are just like people today, where religion is booming. I don't know if, you know, from today, there's lots of the religion's been around for centuries and things, but there's also the New Age movement. I remember my class responding to the New Age movement, and one of the things we had to do is go just to a neighborhood bookstore, and what we saw is how much of the bookstore is expanding from the New Age movement. I had to read a book like The Celestine Prophecy and things. There's nothing based on history, nothing based on geography, nothing based on any empirical or tested evidence at all. Just a lot of times people, how they feel. And people like crazy will tell you today that they're spiritual. It's just some buzzwords. Like, yeah, I don't like organized religion. I don't go to church. I'm very spiritual. You just kind of, this way, yeah, and so what makes you spiritual? Well, I'm going to go take a trip to India. I'm going to look at some crystals for a while and just see what kind of powers in the world or positive emotion, which, you know, positive feeling I should go this way or that way. And like, are you crazy? You're basing your life on these things? Well, Paul said, I can see that you guys are on a personal journey. You're on a journey to be religious. Whether it's based on anything or not, I can see, Athens, that you are a religious people in every way. And he's not kidding. There's hundreds of these stones and statues all around. They're just as religious as the world is today. Verse 23, Paul says, for as I walked around and looked carefully at your objects of worship, I even found an altar with an inscription to an unknown God. You can imagine that. He's doing his homework. He's doing his research as he's getting prepared for this talk with these people, and as he's looking around, that statue over there, he comes with finally kind of some kind of ornamental pillar of something that says to the unknown God. And that's because the Greeks believed that sometimes these gods got angry and they would come against human beings, or they're very suspicious and things, and so they didn't want to leave a god out. So they figured, if some god comes back and we don't have any commemorative things recognizing him, we can bring him over here and say, look, we've been expecting you. You're the unknown one that we didn't recognize, but look, it's you. It's the just in case God. I think, wow, that's just crazy, Alan. You know what? Every year you must notice there's a higher attendance on Easter and Christmas. Lots of people. And they come those couple of times a year. just in case. Maybe it's right. You know, I don't want to put up with the preacher all the time, but I can sure as heck do it 2 times a year, just in case. Just in case, you know, if there's anything, you know, religious that can earn me someplace in heaven, and if that part of that happens to be going to church or, you know, putting a dollar in the plate or anything I can do just to have God look a little favorably on me, just in case, we put that in there. Well, when you're a society with a just-in-case deity, Paul picks up on this. He knows these guys are guessing. And so he kind of comes to him and goes, come on, guys, you guys are guessing. Got an unknown God over there. Come on, you're guessing, right? And they're kind of like, yeah, we're guessing. When he begins in from that, he's built a platform in which to talk to him. He says in the next verse, so you are ignorant of the very thing you worship, and this is what I'm going to proclaim to you. Here's this brilliant bouncing off point. This is what I'm going to proclaim to you. The God who made the world and everything in it is the Lord of heaven and earth and does not live in temples built by human hands. And he's not served by human hands as if he needed anything. Rather, he himself gives everyone life and breath and everything else. And from one man he made all the nations that they should inhabit the whole earth. And he marked out their appointed time and history and the boundaries of their lands. God did this so that they would seek him and perhaps reach out for him and find him, though he is not far from any one of us. What a rich theological group of scriptures here. God is too big for your little boxes, humans. God is too big for even your big temples. God is certainly too big for the little statues you think he's in. God is large and in charge. He's built everything in the universe, and he doesn't need to live in temples you've built with your little human hands. He doesn't need anything from you. And all the things that he's built and the time that he's made for you and given you life and marked out the boundaries of everything you've seen in the universe is so that that general revelation would drive you to the personal revelation of knowing Jesus. And God did this so that you would seek him. That you'd know you'd have no excuse for gravity and the physics and the earth and all the forces of how much the ocean can come up to the shore. He did all this so that you would seek him and perhaps reach out for him and find him. But really, he's not far from any of us at any given time. Whether you're in some other country, whether you're an astronaut on the moon, whether you're just here in Eugene, Oregon, God is not far from you. Paul, he's about ready to give some more information, some important information. And he's not going to get it from the Bible. Like, where's he going to get it from? He's got to share from the Bible. It's got to be correct. It's got to be theologically sound. But he's not going to get it from the Bible because we remember the Bible didn't exist. And so he's going to reach into some truths from the Greek writings themselves that make a biblical truth, because truth is truth. In verse 28, for in him we live and move and have our being. As some of your own poets, as some of your own Greek writers have said, we are his offspring. Therefore, since we are God's offspring, we should not think that this divine being is like gold or silver or stone, an image made by human design and skill. It's like, ha, your own writings of old talk about God in which we are his offspring. How silly would it be for us to come from a gold or silver or stone statue made of human hands? I mean, come on, feel how brilliantly made you are. Feel your heart beating inside you. Touch your nose. Breathe on yourself. Did you come from a statue? Duh, no. Your Greek writers knew that. Your old poets from days of old have said we've came from some kind of divine God that could produce life, that could design life, that could inspire something as big as this universe. It's got to bring to the obvious fact that no matter what you believe, no matter where you're from or your history, you'd feel a little bit dumb, I would think. Especially if you look like, yeah, the Greek writings, our own Greek writers did talk about, you know, we're God's offspring, and certainly that statue right there couldn't have offspring. Stones don't have offspring. Life doesn't come from things that aren't life, and we could go back and disprove evolution still by spontaneous generation. Doesn't happen. Life never comes from something that's not life. Well, verse 30, Paul starts getting a little personal. He starts digging a little bit. And you're feeling, I know you're feeling for Paul already. Is he going to get kicked out of here too? Verse 30 says, in the past, God overlooked such ignorance. Not that you're stupid, you just don't know. But now he commands all people everywhere to repent. You know, in the past, general revelation, you could at least claim a little ignorance or thing. But now, he's got a lot of confidence in the now in which he knows. At least causing these Greeks to think, well, does this guy know something we don't know? Does he have something real to say that we should think about? The word repent means to turn. To turn from your ways, to make a change from the way your life was going, to make a turn, a 180 degrees turn, and go the other direction. And Paul's challenging these guys. You guys need to make a turn. You need to repent. And you know what these guys are thinking? If you're going to make me repent, if you're going to change, well, I'm best with Epicureans who just hedonists, who just love pleasure. Like, hey, if I'm going to have one less joint, one less drink, you know, man, you better have some proof. You know, you better know what you're talking about because I like my life the way it is. It's the same with us today. A lot of times people resist the idea of God. They don't want to be accountable to a God. They don't have to listen to a God. They just want to listen to themselves. And so Paul's saying, hey, there's some accountability here. Well, so they're saying, hey, if this guy wants to make some kind of change in our lives, he wants to affect my life and go a different direction, and he wants me to believe in something, I'm going to need something to go on. I'm going to need proof. Isn't that what we want? A lot of us, you want fire from heaven. You want God to show up in some incredible ways because his divine revelation, his personal revelation, or his general revelation hasn't been enough for you, but you're just all kind of looking for some proof. Well, in verse 31, Paul addresses this. For he has set a day when he will judge the world with justice by the man he has appointed. He has given proof of this to everyone by raising him from the dead. Paul's completely serious about this. Paul's experienced this, and that's why he's saying this like this. This is why Paul was willing to, as a Pharisee with a great job, with great pay, as a zealot, passionate about what he was living for, turns and changes 180 degrees to become the champion of the very thing he persecuted. And he goes from city to city to share this because he's got such great confidence in it. Why? Because he's seen it. Because he's experienced it. Aren't you frustrated when you've just seen something with your own eyes and someone kind of comes and just bets you something different? Like, yeah, I'll take that bet because I've seen it. Well, Paul's like this with these guys. He's saying he's given us proof. He's raised him from the dead. And they all know he's talking about Jesus because all the way back in the marketplaces and the synagogues, he was talking about Jesus. And you know he mentioned Jesus being crucified and resurrected from the dead. So when he's talking about, hey, the man he's appointed, he's given proof of this to everyone by raising him from the dead. To move from the point of, I think so, or I hope so, or just in case, to, I know so. I've seen it. It's real. It can change your guys' life. Of course, you know how these guys responded, right? Verse 32, there's when they heard about the resurrection of the dead, they quickly repented and began to destroy all the lifeless idols they had foolishly worshipped over the years. Don't you think that's what happened? Not. I think I even got a slide that says, not. Because that didn't happen. Because it's about the same thing that happened when I share a lot of times about the gospel with someone new that hasn't heard the gospel. So believable because exactly the same thing happened here as we read from the real verse 32. When they heard about the resurrection of the dead, some of them sneered. Yeah. Sure. Someone resurrect from the dead. Really? That's all you got? Come on, we know people don't raise from the dead. But others said, we want to hear you again on this subject. And at that, Paul left the council. You know, the reason people sneer is It's probably easy for you to understand. I mean, you don't really hold it against the people that sneer that much. They sneered because people don't generally rise from the dead. Not only generally, but you never see it. I've never seen it in my lifetime. I don't see people rise from the dead. It's against natural law of what I know to be true. And I wouldn't believe it myself, and I wouldn't preach about it. I sure wouldn't give my whole life to this if that's all I had to go on. But I had to read ancient documents collected over years and years of time by so many different authors and so many different people saying the same thing, that this Jesus Christ is Lord. He raised from the dead. And I had to think, what do I have to disprove that? What do I have to say those guys were nuts? What do I have to say that that is not real? Paul, you must have been drinking something when you saw that light. You must have been with that platoon of soldiers, but you were drinking on the job that day. Some sneered. Some are still sneering today. Some in a crowd like this, I share with my whole heart that Jesus is Lord. You need to receive him into your life to have life. Life abundant, not only just life abundantly and free, but life to its fullest and life eternal. I want everyone to have eternal life. What am I motivated by? I'm motivated by, I think it's the truth. I want you to have life. I want you to have it to the fullest. I want you, even after this life ends for you, I want you to go on living. Because Christ conquered even death. And so some are going to sneer, but you can see that some, hey, I'd like to hear a little bit more about this. And we have that too. Thankfully, it's not up to us anyway. Jesus said, no one comes to the Father except the Spirit draw him. Thankfully, we have the Holy Spirit, the power of the Holy Spirit. If this is making any sense to you today, it's because the Holy Spirit is prompting your heart and your mind to understand things that are ordinarily not completely understood. And the Holy Spirit, we depend on him for people to receive the truth of life. In Acts 17:34, to end it, it says, but some joined him and became believers. That day, because Paul was willing to get in trouble one more time a little bit, some people joined the body of Christ. And we'll see some of the people in heaven that were there today or that day at the Areopagus. We'll see some of those that were there that day in heaven because of what Paul decided to do that day. What did these people believe in? What was their starting point? What was the beginning point for them? Was it what the Bible says? No. Because the Bible didn't exist. The starting point for these people that came back to hear most of them, and some of them became followers, doesn't begin with what the Bible says. It begins with, who is Jesus? Who's Jesus? And so they came back to ask Paul further questions. All right, Jesus. All right, Paul, you seem to know this guy really well. Who is he? What is he? What has he done for me? Has he done something for me? What? Tell me all about that. The question today is, do you know Jesus? Do you know him as Lord, personal Savior, King of Kings? Do you know him personally, or is he some far-off God, or is he something that's just part of your religion? Is this something that is just the Bible, that talks about in the Bible? You think of just one textbook that you just read from cover to cover, and you think, well, I don't know if that was a very good novel. I don't think that was a very, you know, good writing and things. Or is it a collection of documents written over thousands of years that point to one substantial truth that's never been able to be disproven? That Jesus Christ is Lord. And he wants us to seek him, and he wants us to know him, and he wants us to find him because he loves us that much. That he went to a cross to be nailed to it and resurrected to give us life to the fullest. That's his claim. That's his truth. That's the starting point. So who is Jesus? Do you know him? Do you have a relationship with him? We're going to celebrate that fact with communion if we could have our ushers come forward to rejoice over that fact. We celebrate this once a month, the elements of taking the body of Christ and the blood of Christ. Because it's the actual body of Christ that we receive. We loved him because he first loved us. And if you're a believer today, we invite you to participate with us in this celebration. and rejoice in that as an ongoing truth that's living in you and through you in life. If you don't yet know this Jesus, my invitation is to you to come to know him through a prayer. Jesus, come into my life. I want to know you. I repent of my sins. I want you to take the reins, make me holy, rule in my heart. And we celebrate all of that truth here, but after the service, I'd love for you to come back and see me in the connection room just down the hall and to talk about this message, to talk about this God, talk about joining his church body, any of those things we'd love to talk to you about. But right now, we're going to just focus on Jesus alone and his body that was broken and bruised for us.